our YouTube channel Make Science Easy with Dr. KMC. Today we are delighted to see you all to have a insight about Inter-River Linking Project, IRL. This is the important title of today's need of the hour, linking north to south. We know all that water is undoubtedly the most important natural resource on the planet, as it sustains all aspects of life in a way that no other resource can. United Nations agencies and World Bank have claimed that those scarcities will escalate in the future, creating a serious problems for humankind and the environment. India needs to adopt a crystal clear water machine that can help us to use available water resources to fields, villages, towns and industries round the year without harming our environment. Keeping in mind the increasing demand for water, the Government of India has developed a new national water policy which claims that water is a prime natural resource, a basic need and a precious national asset. India's National Water Development Agency, we call it as NWDA, has suggested the interlinking of rivers of the country. The proposal is better known as Inter-River Linking Project, we call it IRL. It is a mega project. It is a mega project that engages money, resources, engineering, management and human understanding. So it is designed to ease water shortages in western and southern India and aims to link 30 major rivers. So we will see that what are the major advantages of the project ILR. It creates the central potential to increase agricultural production by an additional 100% over the next 5 years. Avoid the losses of the type that occurred in 2002 early to the extent of nearly $550 million by the loss of crops because of extreme drought or the flood condition. So it can save millions of dollars per year in a foreign exchange by avoiding importing of the oil. It unifies the country by involving every panchayat as a source and a shareholder and implement agency. It provides for enhancing the security of the country by an additional water line of the defense. It provides the employment to the 10 lakh people for the next 10 years. It eradicates the flooding problems which occur in the northeast and the north every year. It solved the water crisis situation by providing alternative perennial water resources. It has the large canals linking the rivers are also expected to facilitate inland navigation too, and it increasing food production ultimately from about 200 metric tons a year to 500 metric tons. So it also finally boost the annual average income of every farmers in India from the present $40 per acre of land to over $500 in American currency. So what is the project rationale? The project that the Supreme Court and the President have enjoined the government of India to implement may well be the largest infrastructure project ever undertaken in the world, and transferring water from surplus river basins to ease the water shortages in western and southern India while mitigating the impacts of the recurrent floods in the eastern India. So the project will build 30 links and approximately 3000 shortages to connect 37 Himalayan and peninsula rivers to form a gigantic South Asian water grid. The canals plan to be 50 to 100 meters wide and more than 6 meters deep will facilitate the navigation of water. It estimates, the project estimates of the key project, the variable still in the nature of back of the developed calculation suggests that it will cost a staggering Indian rupees of nearly 5,60,000 crore at cost about in 2002 prices, which handles nearly 178 kilometer cube of the river basin or inter-river basin water transfer per year. It built nearly 12,500 kilometer of canals, create 35 gigawatts in hydropower capacity of the electricity, add 35 million hectares to India's irrigated areas, and finally generate an unknown volume of navigation and fishery benefits. Approximately 3,700 megawatt would be required to lift water across the watershed ridges up to 116 meters. For from 2016, the most observers agree that this project may not only fully understand and fully complete even by 2050. The water technologist Verghese in 2003 itself mentioned that one of its few champions outside the government suggest it should be viewed as a 50 to 100 year project. So the ILR project is conceptualized in two distinct components. Number one, the Himalayan and Peninsula. The farmer will transfer 33 kilometer cube of water, and the latter will transfer 141 kilometer cube of water through a combined network of nearly 1500 kilometer long canals according to NWDA. So the Himalayan component with 16 river links has two subcomponents. The first will transfer the surplus waters of Ganges and Brahmaputra rivers to Mahanadi basin, and from there the water will relay to Godavari, and Godavari to Krishna, Krishna to Pennar, and Pennar to the Kaveri basins, and finally to the Vaigai and Gundar river basins. The second, the subcomponent will transfer water from the eastern Ganges tributes to benefit the western parts of the Ganga and the Sabarmati river basins. So altogether, these transfers will mitigate floods in the eastern parts of the Ganga basin and provide the western parts of the basin and irrigation and water supplies. So the Himalayan component needs several large dams in Bhutan and Nepal to store and transfer food waters from the tributes of the Ganga and Brahmaputra rivers, and also within India to transfer the the surplus waters of the Mahanadi and Godavari, the rivers. The peninsular component has 16 major canals and 4 sub-components. Number 1, linking Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna, Kaveri, Vaigai rivers. Number 2, linking west flowing rivers that are south Dapti and north Bombay. 3, linking of Ken Betwa and Parvati and Kailash Sindh, the Chambal rivers. And 4, diverting the flow in some of the west flowing rivers to the eastern side. So the en route irrigation under the peninsular component is expected to irrigate a substantial area as proposed under NRLP. So this area to be irrigated is situated in arid and semi-arid western and peninsular India. Come to the total cost. The total cost of the project includes 3 components. Number 1, the peninsular component will cost about nearly 1,06,000 crore. Number 2, the Himalayan component will cost about nearly 1,85,000 crores. And third, the hydroelectric component, the project will cost nearly 2,70,000 crore. The quantity of water diverted to the peninsular component will be 141 cubic kilometers, and in the Himalayan component it will be 33 cubic kilometers. So the total power generated via the hydroelectric component will be 34 gigawatts and 4 gigawatts in the peninsular component and 30 gigawatts in the Himalayan component. So the altogether the ILR will handle 4 times more water than the Ganges dam, 5 times all inner and inter basin water transfer completed in the USA, and more than 6 times the total transfer of the 6 inter basin water the transfer projects already operational in India, namely all those which are having the Sardar Sayak, and then the Satluj, the Madhobar, Beast Link, and then Kurnool Kodapa, and then Periyar, Vaigai Link, and then the Telugu Ganga. So here the ILR cost as presently the guess estimated would be 3 times of the cost of the China's South North Water Transfer the schemes, and 6 times of the cost 3 Ganges project, and 20 times the estimated cost of the Red Dead connection in the Middle East. Altogether, this ILR will require a large investment than the sum of the total of all the irrigation investments made by the governments of the colonial and free India since 1830. And this cost is based on numbers that are little more than a conservative the guess estimate that more than the likely excludes the cost of the land acquisition. So when the cost of land acquisition and rehabilitation and settlement, besides the endemic cost and the inevitable time overturns are factored in, ILR will cost likely most and then several times more than the present $123 billion estimate. So only 9 of the 30 proposed links are independent and can execute it without working on other links. So here in the first stage of this mammoth project, which can won government approval last August, yet 230 kilometer canal will be dug to divert water from the Ken River to the Betwa River in the northern Madhya Pradesh, the provenance. A dam and small hydroelectric project plant will be built in the Pannar Tiger Reserve. Work on this nearly $1.1 billion costing first component of the NRL project is underway, and is scheduled to be completed in another 8 years. So what is the justification of the ILR project? The most significant question being raised about ILR by critics is its justification. The Raritan D entry of the project is the accentuating water scarcity in western and peninsular the India. The low per capita availability of the unutilizable water, high spatial and temporal variability of rainfall, and the associated droughts and floods are other major factors. So by 2050, the per capita water availability in India is expected to fall from the present 1820 meter cube to 1140 meter cube, far less than the water scarcity thresholds of nearly 1700 meter cube per person per year defined by the Falkenmark et al. 1994 as necessary for civilized living. So spatial, the inequality too is extreme. The Ganga, Brahmaputra, the Meghna basins, which cover one third of the country's total land area, are home to nearly 44% of India's the population and drain more than 60% of the country's water resources. And two, in contrast, the Krishna, Kaveri and the Penna river basin and the eastward flowing rivers between Pennar and Kanyakumari cover 16% of the total land area and host 17% of the population, but drain only 6% of the India's water resources. So here in India, 19 major river basins, only 55% of the total water resources are unutilizable and make it as a utilizable. As a result, more than 220 million people have a per capita water supply that is below 1000 meter cube per year, indicating the emergence of several regional water scarcities according to the Falkenmark et al. During 1994. So owing to these unequal endowments, the India's river basins are at different degrees of closure. The Indus basin withdraws more than 1600 meter cube per person per year, whereas Brahmaputra basin withdraws only 290 meter cube per person per year. The Indus, Pennar, Tapti, the Sabarmati, the west flowing rivers in Gach, Saurashtra, Rajasthan regions, and the east flowing rivers between Pennar and Kanyakumari suffer overdevelopment or physically water scarce. So these needs of these areas can be addressed, it is argued, by augmenting their natural flows through the transfer of surplus water from the Himalayan rivers. So it is argued that diverting a portion of the surplus flood waters from Himalayan rivers into the drought prone areas can only be a win-win the proposition and a proper solution. So annual floods an average affect more than 7 million hectare of the total land area in India, of which 3 million hectare of the cropped area and 34 million people, mostly in the eastern parts, and inflicts an annual damage of well over rupees 1000 crores have been mentioned by the various water technologies. In contrast, the recurrent droughts affect 19% of the country, 68% of the cropped area, and 12% of the Indian population. So the reservoirs, the shortages, and the canal diversions in the ILR project are expected to reduce the flood damage by 35% and ease drought the proneness in semi-arid and arid parts, besides making 12 kilometer cube of water available for the domestic and industrial water supplies in these drought prone districts. So India is also blamed for having neglected the shortage creation, resulting in the economic water as in the areas of the and mainly have been affecting the economic growth. On other side, the arid and semi-arid regions of the world have invested heavily in shortage and storage of the creation. The USA and also a part of the per capita, the shortage or storage of the capacity of nearly 5,961 meter cube. Australia has 4,717 meter cube, and Brazil has 3,388 meter cube, and even China has increased its per capita storage capacity to 2,486 meter cube, while India's per capita storage capacity is and puny is only 200 meter cube per person at present and declining with increasing population. So it is imperative that India increases its storage for regulating the vast amount of the runoff that otherwise cannot be benefited and beneficially utilized. So the NRLF water transfers of nearly 178 kilometer cube will increase utilizable water surface water resources by 25% and improve the water accessibility in water scarce the regions. So as a concept, the ILR has been doing the rounds for over a century. However, as a serious proposition, it has not been recommended by anyone. So even the National Commission on the Integrated Water Resource Development, which considered the proposal in the great detail, was the lukewarm towards its implementation and actually suggested creation in considering the project as a solution to water distribution problems. And who then are the proponents of the ILR projects? There is a difficult question, because besides a small group of large-scale irrigation, the proponents, the Supreme Court and President of India, the votaries for the NRLP are far less vocal than the growing the lobby of the antagonist of the project. So the NCT WRD report, which is widely reviewed in lay circles as the first case and cut the justification of the NRLP idea, emphasized the self-sufficiency in food production and improved the rural livelihoods as two key the justifications for the ILR project. Assuming the criticality of the maintaining national food self-sufficiency and agricultural exports, the Commission projected a gain demand in the range of nearly 425 to 494 million tons for India by 2050 and argued for the need to increase the country's irrigation potential from 160 million hectare, which is 20 million more than that what can be achieved without basin transfers. So that is, thus it is, stated one of the most effective way to increase the irrigation potential for increasing the food grain production and mitigating the floods and droughts and reducing the regional imbalances in the availability of water is the interlinking of rivers to transfer water from surplus rivers to the deficit areas. So the surface irrigation of the river linking project alone expects to hold 25 million hectare of the irrigated land. However, the NCI WRD Commission was not unanimous in its support for river linking. Some of the members issued a dissenting view that is included in the report itself. Improving rural livelihoods is advanced as another justification for the ILR project. The rural population of India is projected a peak at about 775 million by 2015 UN, it was mentioned. So the Commission projects I mean projects that the rural population will increase, and then again to stated that the population will decrease to about 610 million by 2050, which will be similar to the rural population levels in the 1988. The agriculturally active population estimated in 1988 was 488 million according to FAO, and with the present levels of the economic growth, however, one would expect that the population whose livelihood that depend solely on agriculture to be inevitably much lower than today's level of nearly 548 million in 2001. So thus it is not clear how total agricultural dependent livelihoods in the future can be a justification for the NRLP irrigation, the transfers. So none of the critics determine and undermine the seriousness of the specter of the water scarcity in Western and Peninsula India. But according to them, just because of the Brahmaputra, which accounts for the bulk of India's water resource flow rather inconveniently in a remote corner of the country, does not constitute a good enough reason for a canal and dam building spree on the scale proposed. So here the critics argue that there are other the solutions besides ILR which have not been properly considered. A strong and stringent the army of the water warriors argue that if the precipitation within the watersheds and sub-basins is harvested and conserved properly, meeting the domestic water needs will not be a problem in most parts of our India. So according to that, the India is experiencing a loss of nearly 36 kilometer cube in that year alone, and through the evaporating from the reservoirs, and is what it was mentioned by the water technologies. So some critics point to the desalinization as a viable component in creating an alternative to the NRL project, especially as the desalinization is no longer considered and prohibitively expensive. So the capacity for desalinating water was increased globally. I mean, it nears to 1.5 million meter cube per day to the current figure of more than 20 million meter cube per day. And this has reduced the cost prices of the desalinized water to less than nearly 1 meter cube of the US dollar per seawater and less than 0.50 meter cube per US dollar for blackish water. So a lot of the controversy still is going on and for that, but altogether what we are thinking, irrigation is no longer and water the land but supplying water for growth of crops, according to IA 2003. And he argues that the answer to the sharing problem in the Kaveri lies in both Tamil Nadu and Karnataka, and learning to reduce their excessive demands on the waters of the river through a combination of the measures, the shortage will then disappear. Next, we are going to see what is the benefits and costs of the ILR project. So the ILR project envisages many benefits. It expects to add 34,000 megawatt of hydropower to the national grid, of which 3,500 megawatt would be used in various leaves, supply much indeed the drinking water to several millions of people, and industrial water supplies to drought prone area and water scarce cities in the west and south, mitigate floods in the east and droughts in the west and the south. The large canals linking the rivers are also expected to facilitate inland navigation, increased irrigation, and which needs to nearly 25 million hectares through surface irrigation and 10 million hectares through groundwater irrigation in water scarce western and peninsula regions is the top the benefit envisaged from the ILR project. So this is expected to generate more employment and boost crop output and farm incomes and provide multiplier benefits through the backward linkages such as farm equipment and input supplies and forward linkages such as agro-processing industries. So the linking project has come under the criticism. The most the eloquent has been from the Roth 2003. So based on simple and back of the envelope the calculations, Roth shows that assuming 7% of the interest rate per year, the annual capital cost and interest to recover the total capital over a period of 50 years will be rupees 2015 acre per acre in the peninsular component and 15,030 per acre in the Himalayan component. For irrigating hydro, that is the sorghum in peninsular India, he shows that the required annual capacity or the recovery cost alone will be 4,131 per acre. So similarly, the annual capacity recovery cost at 7% interest over 50 years amounts rupees 13.3 per watt of hydropower. If we assume here 7% of the interest rate to be charged on a capital during the construction period, the total cost of the three components will be around the total amount of nearly 11 crores 47 lakhs and 873 crore, approximately double of water is now suggested. On the further the assumption of 5% of the annual rate of the inflation, the project will commit India's to a project outlay of nearly 100,000 crores per year. The highlights stating that to the southern India, linking of Krishna to Pennar cost about nearly 6,599.8 crores to a stretch of 587.2 kilometer. Similarly, the Kaveri, Vaigai and Gundaru project, which takes a worth of 2,673 crores and which has a length of nearly 255.6 kilometer. So the new aggregated cost of the entire program with the linking of the MSTG, the route en route of the major rivers, is estimated as nearly 4 crores and 44 lakhs crores at 2003-2004 prices. The new aggregated cost of the entire program with the linking of the rivers JTP is estimated as rupees nearly 4 crores 34 lakhs in 2003-2004 the prices. So the concluding of this the project, successful implementation of this project largely looms upon the timely release of water from the surplus basin to the deficit basin. The government of India has constituted a task force to examine the project, comprised of experts from science, engineering, economics and social sciences, and including as official stakeholders one member from a water deficit state and one member from a water surplus state. So it will address the broad issues. Number one, provide guidance for the norms of the appraisal, the individual projects and vice versa, their economic viability, socio-economic impacts, the environmental impacts and preparation of the resettlement plans, develop a mechanism for the speedy consensus among the states, and then prioritize the different projects and propose organizational structures for implementing the project, consider funding modalities for the project and consider the international the ramifications of the project. The completion date for achieving the goal of the interleaving project is December 2050. So amidst the rapid development and urbanization, the updated system of the managing water resources. So it is the high time for India to come forward in all about the manner to transform this dream project into the big reality. So fact is that the ILR projects are site and requirement and specific depending upon the hydrological, the geological, the topographical and the regional conditions. So it is essential that the needed environmental safeguards are properly implemented in a coordinated manner by various agencies. We have to develop a range of models that agree to use shared data sets and explore the definitions of water use for the consumption. If water transferred from water abundant and the rivers to the water deficit areas, there would be adequate supply for everyone in every part of the country. It also appears to promote the national integration and a fair sharing of the country's the natural water wealth. So India's river linking project shows and promises a great concern for water conservation, the optimum use of the available the water, the resources. So thereby I request all them, all the citizens, and you have to think rationally how to make the project in a constructive way for the sustainable the development of the agriculture and livelihood of the people. So thus the gigantic construction in the name of the diverting and diverting water to the water scarce areas may prove to be not the most cost effective way of the doing so. Most of the rural areas are suffering from water scarcity. There is no alternative available at local level for harvesting water. For these areas, the option of long distance transfer may not be a good idea, but some of the major criticisms of the project are also be there with reference to the socio-economic viability, environmental impacts, and then displacement and rehabilitation of the affected people. And the challenges are there for the resource mobilization and the geopolitical concern, as well as the domestic political the dynamics. But all together we have to think for the river linking projects, as I mentioned, for the sustainable growth of the livelihood of the people inhabited in the Indian subcontinent, and then also for the production of the agriculture. So with this I would like to thank all the listeners for the patient hearing. Thank you one and all.